Hello, everyone, and welcome to this session on Evaluating Digital Leadership Programs. My name is David Witt. I'll be your host today. I'm speaking to you from my home in San Diego, California, and I promise you'll see the sun coming in from the window. I've asked the sun not to be too, you know, making everyone jealous wherever, whatever part of the world that you're in. And then in just a little bit, I'll be introducing my colleague, Britney Cole. Britney is speaking to us from her home in Waconia, Minnesota, about 30 miles west of Minneapolis. Today's session is definitely built as an insider's session for leadership, learning, and talent development professionals looking to evaluate digital leadership programs. As such, the presentation is going to be a little less formal than it might normally be because it's just us, and we want to be able to chat with you, be able to talk with you, be able to answer your questions. The way that we're going to address your questions is through the group chat feature here on the ON24 platform. So if you'll take a look down in the lower right-hand corner of your screen, you'll see two speech bubbles. Go ahead and click on that. That'll open up the group chat feature, and you'll be able to type in a message that Brittany and I will be able to see, and that'll be the place where we'll be asking you to post your questions. We want you to get a little bit of practice. Brittany and I have shared where we're participating from today, San Diego and Minneapolis. Where are you participating from today? We had over 300 leadership, learning, and talent development professionals register for today's event, and let's find out where you're participating from. Once you've got the group chat box open, just like Lydia has done, hi all. Lydia, let us know where you're joining from today. You guys are doing it perfect. You're watching where people are joining from all around North America, and I'm trying to see if we've got some folks joining from outside. Ivory Coast I saw go by.
It's
from
Reading,
England. That's really great. Thank you for doing that. Again, those who don't have that group chat open, it's in the lower right-hand corner, the two speech bubbles. That'll be the place to ask content questions. We're reserving the Q&A panel just for technical questions. So feel free during the course of Brittany's presentation. She's got about 40 minutes for us. We'll save about 10 or 15 minutes for Q&A at the end. Ask your questions here anytime during the presentation. I'll be asking Brittany those questions on your behalf when we get to Q&A. You'll also see me kind of popping in and out my video. Don't worry, even though my video goes dark below Brittany's, I'm still here. I'm still listening and I'm typing away, but it just makes it a little easier so you're not just seeing me go for 40 minutes while Brittany's talking. But I'll be there and I'll pop back in for Q&A. All right, thank you all for using the group chat feature. I'd like to introduce my colleague, Brittany Cole. Brittany is the Associate Vice President of Innovation and Solution Architecture for the Ken Blanchard Companies. We are really fortunate today. Brittany is a featured speaker in many, many industry trade shows. She's an expert on the topic. And Brittany, thanks for being here with us today to take us on this exploration of evaluating digital leadership programs. Really excited to have you here with us.
Great. Thanks, Dave. I am so thrilled to be here and to spend the next hour with you. As Dave mentioned, this is a chance to learn a little bit, share a little bit. And as we think about this title, Evaluating Digital Leadership Programs, part of you, depending on where you sit in your organization, might be a what do I do now, considering that a lot of the programs and experiences that we have been designing, developing, and delivering may have been paused or canceled or require a complete overhaul. And so as Dave mentioned, here's my picture, but you can also see me on my screen and also the background, so you can tell that I have small kids. And so I will say if there's any busting in of my small children, they are home with me. As if you have children, they're likely at home with you right now. I have been a telework employee my whole career, but I will say the past several weeks or so has been a completely different world in terms of working from home. And as I think about what we've been experiencing, given the rapid state of change in terms of learning and development, we're really, and we think about leadership development and training in particular, it's so much more important to be discerning because we're starting to hear things that we've never heard. For instance, I'm now at home for the foreseeable future. Now what? What does that mean for me as a leader? You might have someone that says, we need to go virtual now. So for instance, if you are a facilitator or you lead a leadership development program or an executive leadership program, and you had upcoming cohorts that were traveling and coming together, and they were going to be in the same place, and you were going to go through some really immersive activities and breakouts and speaker series, you have to do that virtually now, or maybe none at all. And so you're having to reconfigure what that looks like and what it feels like. From the other end, you might have individuals who are looking to save on costs and say, great, now we don't have to do those expensive programs. Let's just curate some stuff. Let's push it out. There's plenty of things out there on working virtually and leading virtual teams because it's not necessarily something that's brand new, but it's something that is new to everybody right now. But you might have gotten your budgets cut and you're having to debate, what do I just hand over some content to people and have them fend for themselves? You might have others who might say, well, maybe this is time to think of a brand new modality and let's get creative and try things like virtual reality or augmented reality or chatbots or other emerging technology platforms. And so as you go from maybe what was traditionally face-to-face to what is now virtual or digital, it's this journey for you as the L&D professional that is wrought with potential landmines and things you never had to consider before. And as I think about preparing for this session that I'm sharing with you today, it actually gave me the opportunity to document and actually write down when I am posed with designing or solutioning or architecting a digital learning experience, what are the things that I ask? What are the questions I ask? What are the levers that I have to consider and have the organization to consider as they design and develop and deploy something digitally? So this exercise and this webinar was really that chance to write that down. And a part of it is, you can maybe think about digital leadership training programs, because again, it's not necessarily something new. However, there's so much out there. I just did a couple screen grabs from a variety of different vendors and services companies, and there's content, and there's experience, and there's virtual training, and there's content passes, and there's open enrollment pieces, and programs, and courses, and online collaborative journeys, all on management and leadership skills. And truly, it's overwhelming to think about. And if we layer on top of that, we're also getting bombarded with a lot of different things from, virtual learning. It's time to do it now. Everything is individualized and personalized and driven by AI and machine learning. And so things and sort of marketing and sales positioning language and value propositioning language, it's coming from everywhere. It's coming from probably your vendor partners. It's coming from technology companies. It's coming from content providers. And if you think about any of these things that are here, it all sounds quite lovely. Yes, I would love to have a platform that looks like Netflix, and so it's easy to use, and it helps me build a community, and it has all of the content I need, and allows my learners to get the individualized attention that they want. And so we're getting those value messages are getting shared with us, and there's so many buzzwords out there, and a lot of them really mean the same thing. And so if we are, you know, having a lot of the same sales messaging, or we look at our programs or our existing technology, and you know, there's redundant features in some of those platforms and in some of that content, you know, how do you choose? And it's, you know, it's much more complicated than a one size fits all approach. I'm going to share this with you quickly, and I'm going to build it out for you. And again, just to make sure I level set, you will have a copy of these slides after, and it'll be the built out version of this. And one of the things, as I started to think about the technology landscape in learning and development and in the HR space, and thinking about that from an employee's perspective, it helped me organize the different technologies. And I'm going to share this with you as an underpinning, because when we think about leadership programs from a digital perspective, there's a lot of considerations. And I'm going to go through seven questions, and the seven, and within those seven questions, the different layers and the different considerations. And as we think of those, I want you to think about the technology layer, because when going digital or virtual, live virtual, like we are here today, everything that we serve up to our audience is now going to be delivered in one of these technologies. And it's so important that we make it easy for our learners. So for instance, any of our employees and any of our organizations, there's some access point. And as we think about any technology ecosystem, whether it's learning or HR or even IT or anything else, there's the point in which you go to first. And for some organizations, maybe that's a SharePoint site, your intranet, maybe it's your LMS, maybe it's a learning experience platform where it aggregates everything. And maybe it's even a custom site that you built because you have other sites that you're pointing to, or a custom app. So there's a lot of different sort of the first place that people go to access learning. But then from there, you have that foundation layer where you could be directed to a variety of different platforms. It could be that larger enterprise learning management system like SuccessFactors or Cornerstone or Saba/Cornerstone, SumTotal. Or you might be considering, well, maybe I'm going to transition to one of the maybe LMS Lite platforms that's not integrated with my HR systems, whether that's Docebo or Litmus or Brig. There's a lot of them out there. Or maybe those LMS systems sit behind one of those learning experience platforms like Degreed or Edcast or Fuse. Or it could be driven by a curation platform like Filtered, which is their Magpie product, or Anders Pink. And I share that because, A, there's a lot out there. And while a lot of those larger LMS organizations were started with the intent to track compliance training, because that was maybe manage instructor-led training and instructor resource management, all of these platforms, all of these four categories, which probably there's many more that are not even on this list, they're all competing. They all want to be the front door. They are competing for your iShare, for our employees' iShare. And so Degreed would want SuccessFactors, for instance, to be integrated. And then you find your SuccessFactors courses through Degreed. But SuccessFactors wants to be the front door as well. And they're integrating their JAM collaboration module. And so they have that more learning experience feel. And so they're all trying to be that place where people go to access learning. But again, it's more complicated than that, because once your employee gets there, then there's the variety of activities and content and social collaboration and events that you want them to engage with. And that could be driven by that platform, or it can be driven by others. For instance, here you see the fifth down social or workforce collaboration tools like Teams, Zoom, ON24, WebEx. You have this opportunity where you can interact and work happens, but it integrates other pieces. And so that could even be a part of the front door, and having your front door be Teams. And then you start to think about the other platforms like reinforcement or sustainment, ebooks, or online mini courses developed in tools like Rise or Inkling. But there's, and then the emerging technology like AR and VR and chatbots. There's so many things, and a lot of those things, some of it can maybe be developed with the content authoring tools of your learning experience platform or your LMS, but some of them don't have that functionality, and you have to think about what is that learning technology ecosystem that, again, is easy for our learners to find. In some organizations, and even in ours, we have a lot of these platforms, and they do the same thing. And so what, as a learning professional, do we want that experience to be so that they go to the same place? And if Yammer is the place where we have social collaboration, or Teams, or Cisco Jabber, and different or Slack, or again, in an LXP, like at Caster Degree, all of those have the ability to be social and to share and to like. And so it's you as a learning professional almost engineering the experience and selecting from the things you have, and then determining based on the things you want to have but don't, how do you create that experience? And again, we'll go into more depth. And then, of course, above and beyond that, we want to measure to make sure what we design and develop and deliver actually makes an impact. And there is a variety of assessment tools in different categories, from surveys to assessment engines to adaptive platforms. And even, again, a lot of those experience platforms that have analytics. And how do you have all those dashboards work together? And if I had to mention, finally, all of those platforms have the ability, most of them have the ability to host content. And so it's not a one-size-fits-all, or if you do a one-size-fits-all, you're gonna trade off a couple of those pieces. And so as you think about, if this is a sliver of the reality of the modern learning ecosystem, from our perspective, how do we decide? How do we evaluate? How do we create something that drives meaning and impact for our leaders and for their employees, so that their employees can be more productive, especially in the social crisis that we find ourselves, but then is still something that is engaging and meets people where they are, which right now we're all at home. At least I'm at home. So let's dive in to those seven considerations. I'm going to walk through each and then use it as a chance for you to ask some questions along the way. So as we think about, this is fairly comprehensive, but there's going to be even more levers that you can consider. But at least if you're considering going to a digital experience, here's some questions you can start to consider as you start to say what is a must-have and what is a nice-to-have and what's a non-negotiable. And here they are, an event or a journey. What's my cohort size, small or large? Do I want this completely self-directed and asynchronous, or more of a guided experience? What's the technology and the combination of technologies do I use? Do I use what I have inside my organization? Do I buy another? Do I borrow and license a technology from one of my partners? From a leadership perspective, Do I really double down on frameworks and models, or do I go a little bit more high level with principles and concepts? What's the role of humans in this journey or this event? And the new roles that are being formed as a result of this change for being a much more remote workforce than we were in the past. And then again, from a content perspective, do you bend, buy, borrow, build? So again, is it curated, custom, or tailored? And we'll talk through, again, each of those. And what I'll share with you is, no matter the answers to these questions for you, they might be right for you for one role or segment, and then for another role or segment, you might have different pieces. And so I hope, too, as you start to look at these different levers that you have available to you, that you have to decide upon, there's two things. Is one, when you make a decision, make sure that this is made with conviction and that you're clear on the trade-offs. Is, for instance, if I go to even just to content, and of course we'll go dive deeper, but if you build custom content versus tailoring existing off-the-shelf content or curating large libraries of publicly available content, being clear that you can articulate the trade-offs of each, because that's really your role as a learning professional, as a consultant, to be able to have those conversations with your leader and with your stakeholders and even with your learners to a certain degree. All right. Are we ready? Let's dive in.
Yes.
Yes. All right. So number one is an event or a journey. And of course, we all want to say journey because that sounds so much better. But I will tell you what, a learning event is sometimes much easier to do. You know, events, a one-time thing, it's one and done and on to the next. And sometimes it is okay to do an event. And again, a lot of leadership development training programs and companies offer events. And even though, those events might be journeys within those events, because there's pre-work and there's sustainment or mastery or post-work, cognitively, it's sometimes easy to say, I have this population of this number of people. I want to give them the opportunity to build mindset, skill set around a particular leadership topic, depending on their role. It allows me to go do that. Depending on my organization, I need to just check something off the box and get to something to market very quickly. And events often require roles that we in L&D might be familiar with. You have your facilitator, you have logistics and fulfillment where you ship and print the stuff, and maybe that becomes more complicated right now where, you know, maybe it's you're delivering and the logistics are PDFs and it's digital content. But really, an event is something that we in L&D and formerly known as training departments have done forever. And we're pretty good at it. We're good at delivering and creating really engaging events. Versus a journey, which could be a series of events. It's, again, not mutually exclusive. But journeys by nature are more complex. You have more events, you have more activities, more modalities, more content, which then means more administration. So even if we think about one of the programs at the Ken Blanchard Company's SL2, you know, you might think, well, SL2 is in the classroom, a two-day event, or virtually, five virtual events. You might think, well, I can make that into a journey, because there's the launch materials where you go through an assessment and then you have your series of events. And in between those events, you have activities. And then post those virtual or face-to-face events, you have mastery tools and different challenges. And so even traditionally, what you might think of as a two-day classroom or a multi-session virtual, those could be and likely are designed as journeys. But to administer a journey, you have to think of it a little bit more broadly. It might require more effort on your behalf to administer. And if you want to measure, it means you have to be more committed to that initiative longer, as opposed to saying, all right, they finished it. I see that they completed it. Great. I'm going to go on to the next group or go on to the next team or go on to the next initiative. Oftentimes as well, when we think about journeys that include multiple events, multiple activities. And again, when I use the word events, I will put that in that 10% of like that, like 70-20-10 of formal. So instructor-led, virtual instructor-led, and even e-learning, like a formal e-learning course, right? The thing that is meant to share knowledge, share concepts, and even possibly drive skills. Yeah, you bet. And when we also think about journeys, again, it starts to think about other services that you might have to in other roles to help draw people in and continue to stay people engaged on that journey, such as services, the coaching role, the facilitation role, the community manager or a moderator or a curator, and the platform or combination of platforms that I'm using to deliver that journey. For instance, if you're leveraging multiple leadership partners, they might have content and their experience, their journey in each of their own respective platforms. What is your role as a learning professional that's in charge of that whole journey to make it still seem cohesive for that audience? And how do you create those threads amongst the piece of it? And so I'm going to share with you just very briefly, and know if you want to learn more about learning journeys. I've done a previous webinar that includes actually some job aids and tools that you can go download on our website. But I wouldn't overcomplicate it either. A journey can be something where you, again, use a series of post-its and you think of all the steps along the way. And so even an event might, again, if you use an event in the journey mindset, you think of all the touch points that a learner engages with you and with the trainer and with the moderator and the people power that are behind in the different platforms. You start to suss out to say, oh, it's much more typically than an event or a course or a class, but all the things that I can do to actually create a learning journey that has common language, that's connected to our strategic goals, to our leadership competencies. Where are the opportunities amongst that journey where it can be personalized and targeted? How can I think about my audience and say, you know, what's going to drive them to feel compelled to not just start the journey, but finish the journey? What am I doing to make sure it's connected and people are connected and collaborative with each other? And again, we'll talk about technology, the tools that can drive that. Where do we give people the space to reflect when we chock full, again, in days of last month, maybe a face-to-face, but days of this month, even a virtual instructor-led training session, those are pretty busy events. And where beyond those events are you giving people the time and the space to reflect? I will share personally with you, I have probably have been working more in the past 2 weeks than in the past 2 months, because being at home and not going anywhere, it's easy to actually go to work. And so were you taking that time to pause and then to diagnose and self-assess? What's that blend between push and pull content? I'm going to get through this, and then Kurt, I see a question from you, and I'll address that. How can I make it real? So again, how can I make it relevant to the people who are actually going through it, and also keep others beyond the participants informed? So the leaders of those participants and then the employees of those participants. In other words, if we had to book it, how can we make that journey or events easy and measurable, an ability to be measured? And again, these are just the things that are in the journey. This is just that one, that first question, event or journey. These are the things that's important to solve for, and you address. And again, to know more about learning journeys, we have a whole one-hour webinar and tools that actually take each of these 10 best practices and give you some questions to start to think about. I'm looking at the chat, and Kurt said, are there digital solutions to scale practice opportunities that were historically done face-to-face? And the answer is yes. What I will do, Kurt, I will just put a note, and when I get to the technology session, I will talk about some of those tools and even probably name drop a couple that I've used throughout my experience that offer some of that one-to-one where you can actually, in a virtual space, drive feedback and have that fluid conversation. All right, so that was number one. Let's go to number two. Again, as we think about evaluating digital leadership development programs, and this number two is going to be irrespective of whether it was digital or not, but this is something that is a big decision for you to make is, do I focus on models or principles or even a combination of both? And so let's talk about that. So when we think about models, leadership models, leadership frameworks, coaching models, SL2 versus versus other, the trust model and a coaching model, is we think about bringing models into an organization, there's some things to think about, is because when you think about a model, it is your mental framework to apply skills. So often models are intended to be the how. So you might have your vision and your mission as your why, competencies or success profiles could be your what, and then the models are the how. How do I have a conversation with one of my employees who has really low competence, but they're really committed because they're brand new to the organization? How do I adjust my leadership style to ensure I'm giving them what they need, which is something that's very directive in nature? I use SL2. So it becomes that mental framework you have on how to have conversations. And in some ways, it's, again, it becomes the basis for things that you use outside formal experience. So it's the basis for performance support. I will share with you just this week, I had a really challenging conversation with my manager on priorities because there's so many priorities right now given just the pace. I took the one-on-one worksheet from SL2 and it became the frame of how I was able to organize the conversation because we needed to clarify alignments. So using models are an easy way to create tools that you can use on the job to help you do the things you need to do to be. To bring in a model, you might have to partner with a provider because some of those models are intellectual property, and you might have to pay a fee, whether that's a fee per person or you have some enterprise agreement. You know, there is a cost to bringing in a model because often that model has the tools, and to have those tools and to have that library, you're possibly paying for that. And when you have too many models, that might be, again, cognitive overload. I think I've said that three times in this session. But you might say, okay, I have this model to have conversations, but I have this model to coach, and I have this model to give feedback, and I have this model to have difficult conversations. Which one do I use when? And when you pepper a digital leadership development program with too many models that aren't seemingly well connected, it causes confusion. So your response to that might be, well, maybe instead of models, I go to more principles or concepts. And when you think about principles or concepts, so things of more of when you say the what, it's more of that checklist. And, you know, I think about all the checklists right now on working remotely. And one of those is be present. And that gives me a good what, but again, it could be, it's more principle-based or concept-based in nature. But when I think about principles, you can easily curate from a variety of sources. So if you already have a variety of content libraries at your fingertips, you can find all the stuff that aligns with that topic, and you can put them together, possibly put some context around them so there's more relevancy to your audience, because truly there's no shortage of stuff out there. Principle-based content could also be used as the basis or the source material to inspire custom-built content for your organization. But at the same time, when you use principle-based content, so again, curated content or even other internal content that you've created, you might notice or you might see that a lot of it is very high level and it doesn't go too deep into the practical application. So again, maybe it's a combination of both, and how do you, again, address the what, but also address the how, which is a lot of our leaders still need that how and require that how, especially when they're new. So again, another question for you to start to consider as you create that digital leadership development program. The next one is cohort size, small or large. So I'm going to start with large, actually, and then go to small. So a large cohort seems sometimes ideal, right? I have a huge organization. I got to reach a lot of people. It could be your chance to make it consistent. Depending on the tools I have at my fingertips, it allows for, some collaboration. I could do discussions. I could do chats, as we're doing today. But it might be challenging to create those small personal connections in a large cohort. I can scroll through and I see comments from Brock and from Jay and Amy, but because it's in a list of chat, I might not necessarily have the opportunity to build personal rapport with them because there's so many of us on the webinar. So it takes longer and we might have to do more things. So we might have to have a journey where we take that large cohort and we create small cohorts and peer groups and maybe those are regional peer groups or global or functional peer groups where they can work together. So again, it kind of pairs back with that journey where if you want to have something that's large cohort, but you want to drive a personal connection, you have to then think about how do I craft opportunities for those small cohorts? And maybe it's not necessarily formal training, because when you have a small cohort, you can have those formal pieces. Again, fundamentally, it's just harder to scale. So again, it's that trade-off is how do I want to have something that's very one-to-one small group to a facilitator where they can get that individualized feedback, where they can have that dedicated time to change mindset and build skill set, things in a virtual environment that would do that are breakout sessions, peer learning circles. There's so many tools popping up on peer-to-peer learning. I just saw one called Circles that TED Talk uses. That's pretty fabulous. Again, even group coaching and, again, those one-to-one live conversations. You can have a blend of large cohort with a small cohort experience, but again, the trade-offs of each, it's basically connection versus scale. And how do you blend the two? Again, another reach based on the size of your organization. The next one, which sort of lends itself to number three around cohort, is what's the human elements? Who are the people and the roles? And I'm gonna kind of put both of them out on the screen instead of building them together. Is when you think about the facilitator role or the trainer role, I'm gonna think about the trainer role January 2020, and maybe that trainer was utilized 80% of the time. They were on platform, in a classroom. Maybe they were traveling a lot, going from class, session to session, or maybe they're home-based and they're going through new hire or other onboarding or other sales training or leadership training. And the facilitator role in March 2020 in today's world might be virtual, but really, and so they're not traveling, and maybe their utilization has completely changed because classes have been canceled, or you're considering the conversion to virtual, and the skill set of a trainer who is primarily a face-to-face trainer, to a virtual facilitator, there's some fundamental different skills. And so that individual who, you know, is the content expert and leads those formal events, you know, there's other ways in a digital leadership experience where you can draw them in. And that can be through things like, yep, Wendy, that's the platform I just mentioned. They can host office hours or create videos in support of a digital journey. And so for one of our clients, we are using the facilitator role to have open office hour sessions multiple times in a given week at different time zones. So our large cohort can engage when it makes the best time to connect with them. And so the role of the facilitator, they might have to learn new skills and maybe have to be more tech savvy in order to manipulate these platforms that you might have in your organization with or without a producer type role. The other role is the evolution of maybe what was a content developer or even an instructional designer to maybe someone, if it is a journey, you know, the role of a moderator or curator or community manager. Again, there's so many different names and words, but again, someone who is in charge of fostering engagement. So if we think about L&D pulling a page from the content marketing playbook, this individual is in charge of pull through, making sure that people join in and stay engaged. So maybe that's setting up communities of practice or hosting those office hours and sparking conversation. Maybe they're curating and maybe even creating some content based on the trends that they're hearing. In my previous organization, I had the opportunity to design a program on future of work skills. And one of them we identified as emotional intelligence. And a part of our self-assessment, we asked them about their ability to be influential in their organization. And we saw that that organization was extremely, two on a scale from seven of how they felt their ability to influence. And, you know, that helped us drive a completely other element of the program that might not have been there. And that wasn't done as a formal request. And the role of the person who crafted that new program and pushed that out to that audience was that moderator role, because they are, again, they're connected to that journey longer beyond maybe one event or one implementation of a pathway or a plan. And they're sense making the things that are the audience needs, and they're responding to that in real time. So again, what's that human element even in a digital experience? All right, the next one is something is this an experience that you want self-directed or guided? And again, in some ways it goes to the event or journey, but you can still have a journey that's self-directed. But to do so, you have to think about what are the things that I have to do to make it easy for that individual to actually go through the journey on their own. So what's great about self-directed journeys is it gives them a lot of autonomy and choice. You'll find out right away what's not relevant to them, because they're not going to consume it because they don't have to. When you do have something that's more self-directed, you might have to make sure if they especially have the ability for choice and they can pop around in any direction, that content and activities to some degree should stand on its own. But when we think about self-directed journeys, you know, you have to think about what are the frameworks that we're giving them so that they can stay on time and on task, because maybe they want that guided experience, but you don't have that opportunity. And so can we give them a roadmap? What are some of the things, because again, in a self-directed journey, you might assume that they're motivated and they're accountable for practicing and mastering skills. And so what are the things you have to think about and maybe trade off to say, if I don't have anybody asking or events that are prompting, if they're actually practicing those skills with their peers or having those conversations with their managers and using the tools that we're giving them, How do we ensure that that's happening? And maybe that's where, again, you think about more of a guided experience where it's still asynchronous, so maybe it's non-cohort in nature, but it gives them some structure. Maybe it's a way to package across multiple content providers where you're like, here's your journey. Again, this journey is up to you to complete, but here's the things that if you are interested in this, here's the way you want to go. And so you're providing, maybe that's custom content, which we'll talk a little bit more about. Maybe it's technology driven and leveraging some of the tools and recommendation engines that you have based on the investments you're making. But again, trading that off with the people power and your bandwidth and your team's bandwidth or your partner's bandwidth and budget, I suppose, of how do you have something, again, is more self-directed or guided. And again, that plays a lot with the journey piece. All right, I have two more, and I think we're doing pretty good on time, so we have some a chance to answer some questions, is around content. So do I want curated public content? Do I want custom content? Do I want off-the-shelf licensed content that I tailor? So what is that? What is that right blend? And the right blend might be, and I will probably say likely, should be a combination of all three when you think about leadership programs. Because again, with curated content, there's a ton out there. And there's a ton out there that is usable. And with a lot of the technologies that large organizations are using, curated content is included. So for instance, if you have SuccessFactors, you might have TED Talks integrated in, or you might have Business Insider or other freemium type sites where you can sort of look and suss out to a certain degree what's out there and what you want to use. When you have all the contents at a learner's fingertips, it could create learner fatigue and cause confusion because there's 1,000 things on how to build trust. So when you give them everything without pointing them to what is recommended, and it's exactly why in this session I saw a couple of questions is, what do you recommend around technology? Because there's so much out there. So again, what is our job in recommending the best public content out there? I will share this with you as well. When I started with Blanchard, I was amazed at all the publicly available content that is out there that our organization has created, whether it's the Leader Chat podcast, which is free, and they're great, and they're all thought leadership driven. The Ask Madeline blog, which are issues based. So there's so much out there. But again, even if you gave them that podcast site or that blog site, what are the ones that are most relevant to that audience? And then you might find, well, none of it's relevant, and I really need to build something that's custom because it's reflective of our organization and our own needs. And maybe that's because you need something that's role specific, or you might need something that is a model, excuse me, that you built in-house that you have to create because you created it. So you have to build the content to support it. But again, if you're in the custom content game, you know that it can take longer to build, even though there's lots of tools out there now that you can build custom pieces rapidly. You have to keep it up to date, so you're in charge of maintenance. But on the flip side, because you built it and it's for your organization, it tends to be much more relevant and contextual to the learner. And then the third option is you tailor, or you take off-the-shelf content, and you have to think about, okay, I'm using SL2, but I really want to connect it to my performance management process. And so what are the possibly custom pieces, or at least the custom messaging that I have to build to tailor so it is relevant, so it doesn't seem like it's just another piece of public content? So again, when you think about licensed content, you also have to answer the question of, where does that licensed content live? Do I do an integration with my LMS? Do I go to the provider's platform, which they all have and we all have? Is it a combination of both? Do I go to my leadership partner, and that's where I go through SL2, say I'm Blanchard Exchange, but then all of the content is available on my LMS or Learning Experience platform, so I can find it as performance support after the journey. And so content and where it lives really plays into the next one, number seven, is, again, coming full circle to what we talked about before, is technology. And how do you serve this up in a way that is fast, that's easy, that allows me to measure so that I can actually demonstrate to leadership where they're obviously right now, a lot of organizations are looking to curb on costs because the economy is in the global economy is in a state of disarray. How can I ensure what I'm doing is making a difference and is helping leaders and their people get to back to productivity faster? The technology conversation needs to be a part of that, because if we think about technology and you think about all the tools you probably have in your organization and all the features and functions you want, you're probably underutilizing what you have. I would say that's across a lot of organizations. You might have redundant platforms that do across different teams, but you might not like those platforms. Some of our platforms, especially legacy LMS platforms, might not have a nice UX, or it might not be mobile friendly, or the content might not be mobile friendly. So you might have to tap into multiple platforms, and you have to architect how it's easy to navigate all of that. Or you might say, you know what, what's inside my organization just isn't working, or I'm only going to use it for tracking. I need to use something that's off the shelf, that's a package piece that I can put the whole journey in. And even though I might not have everything, it has enough. And I'm going to go with an off the shelf commercial platform, which could be fairly easy to scale. Some have the content baked in. You can add your own content. You flip the switch. And even though I'm saying that's easy, I'm underplaying the ease of implementation and making sure people come back to that field of dreams. But in terms of having something available quickly, an off the shelf or commercial platform could be something that could be appealing and could even help you go to market faster than you would if you were to engineer and kind of rework the platforms you have. Another option is you leverage one of your new platforms, whether that's through a services provider or a content provider. Us at Blanchard have generated partnerships with a lot of different technology platforms to see how we can best blend our leadership point of view and their features of their technology, whether that's coaching tools and feedback tools or even learning journey designs, to make it in such a way that's seamless. So there's, again, a ton of choices, but knowing that you don't have to make those decisions all on your own. So I know I have shared a ton, and I'm sure, Dave, you have a lot of questions that have come out of the chat. I've just kind of looked at those through the corner of my eye. And so we have 7 minutes left, and let's open it up for discussion.
It's great. Thank you, Brittany. That was wonderful content. And it's funny, I've almost got more questions, I think, than when we started, possibly, because you opened up so many possibilities for us. But there are a couple of questions that folks already typed into the group chat that I wanted to ask you with the time that we've got remaining. The first question came in around your recommendation for an easy-to-use LMS for a small company. Is there any LMS that you think would be helpful if you're trying to conduct training, launch some pre-work, keep track of what people have actually accomplished, and you're a small business? Any suggestions?
Yeah, that is a great question. And, you know, I think one of the first questions I would give back to you is maybe your payroll or HR software to see if there's an LMS module in their offering and what the features that they have, if they have that available. Some organizations like Paycom, for instance, which really has had a big play in the SMB space, has their own LMS module now that allows you to build very simple learning paths and host content, which is a key piece. So that would be one piece for you is making sure your LMS question is, do you host content or do I have to figure that out myself? There's a variety of LMS companies out there, small ones, even SAP, even though it's this huge powerhouse in the people performance productivity sort of game, you know, they acquired Litmos last year. And Litmos was designed as that sort of small, easy stand-up LMS. So even though the big players are bringing in some of the small players, I think too, you know, ask yourself, like, what do you want to track? Are you looking to track compliance training? Or are you partnering? A lot of small businesses actually use third parties for things like ethics and sexual harassment and things that people have to do. So you might say, like, what do I need an LMS for? So I know I probably gave you more questions to ask versus some clear answers. But I would say, you know, there's a few and, but lean on your partners, because a lot of your, like, for leadership development, I'll say even Blanchard Exchange is a mini LMS. It tracks, and our clients, and especially a lot of our small clients, are actually using Blanchard Exchange in an administrator role. So they have that mini LMS functionality. So I think that would be is, what are you tracking? And then if you need to track things that are internal, then you probably want to get an LMS internally. But if you are tracking the programs across your providers, you might be able to tap into theirs.
That's great. Thank you, Brittany. Now we are into the last 2 minutes of our session, and I want to give people who have a question that we're probably not going to be able to get to, or maybe it's a complicated question, because some of you are asking some really in-depth questions. So I want to give you an opportunity to get your question answered. Typically, I would have you go ahead and send to an email address, but I want to try something simpler since we've been having so much fun with the group chat feature here. I want to make it as simple as possible because we do, of course, have your registration information. So I'm going to give you a one-word option to get your question answered personally. If you have got a question that you are thinking of asking, but it's, you know, a long question, go ahead and type in the word contact in the group chat, and we will reach out to you and find out what your question is. So just type in contact, hit that submit button, and we'll reach out and find out what your question is. Brittany, the other question that came in, thanks for asking the cohort question. That was one of the ones I had on my list. The other question I had was recommendations, I love this, for a time-starved, tech-inexperienced group. What would you suggest the technology that you would use for time-starved, tech-inexperienced group that you're trying to conduct a program for?
Yeah, that
anything come to mind?
That's a great question. I'll make an assumption when you say that is the audience is tech-inexperienced.
Yes. Yes.
Versus maybe like the who's going to develop it for you. I would say something that is very guided and very structured. So, you know, platforms that I've used, Intrepid is one. They're a collaborative online program. It's very, very easy to build, and you can build your journey. You push it out to them. They do stuff. And then the next week you push out more content. And so something, when you think about a time-starved audience, I'm going to use some SL2 language, being very S1 to say, this is what we expect. This is what we expect anyone to do it. And so they can actually, you know, do that as opposed to something that is anytime, anywhere on demand, they're not going to do it. It's going to seem overwhelming. And so finding platforms that are very programmatic, like Intrepid, NovoEd is another. And then even those micro learning platforms, MindTickle, Exonify, MindMarker, ones that send content on a spaced out campaign basis, where they get it, they answer it, they get some feedback, they move on with their life. So things that they that push to them that they have to go do, and then they can choose later whether or not they respond.
That's great. Thank you, Brittany. Again, you just reminded me again, if you would like to learn more about Intrepid and Mind Gym and a lot of the other tools that Brittany's talking about, do be sure to type in contact and we can go ahead and follow up with you if you'd like to learn about any of those technologies. Because as Brittany said, there's a lot out there and it's hard to sort through it. And to have the opportunity to ask someone who's already explored all of them and can give you some solid recommendations, type in contact and we'll help you with that. Well, Brittany, we are at the top of our time. It was a wonderful hour to spend with you. I really enjoyed it. I know our audience did also. I want to thank you for taking the time to share what you've learned about evaluating digital leadership programs. Thank you so much for your time today. And then on behalf of the Ken Blanchard Companies, we want to thank all of you who have been with us today and are actively exploring digital learning options in a changing time. It's really, in a lot of ways, moving us a lot faster in something we were already going. But it's like, okay, moving along very fast now. So thank you for joining us. We hope you'll join us again soon at another Blanchard event in the near future. Thanks, Brittany. Thanks to all of you.
Guys.
Have a good rest of your day. Bye, everyone.
Bye.